The next item on the order paper is a motion on equal pay. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour and 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the marshalled list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the inequality of treatment which has arisen for staff in the PSNI, the Department of Justice and the Northern Ireland Office in terms of the Equal Pay Settlement, recognises the genuine hurt and hardship which have been caused as a result, and calls on the Minister of Finance and Personnel and the Minister of Justice to take urgent steps to recognise their moral obligation and to ensure that staff affected are not financially disadvantaged and receive the equivalent payments awarded to their colleagues in other departments.
I call Leslie Cree to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker. I am pleased to move this motion today in yet another attempt to resolve the inequality and unfairness of the situation about the equal pay settlement for police support staff in the PSNI and those seconded from the former Northern Ireland Office, now the Department of Justice. The matter has been dragging on since 2009 and was the subject of a debate in this House in June 2013. Many questions have been asked in this House about the equal pay issue, and it was the subject of a County Court judgment on the 7th of March 2013. The judgment held that there had been pay delegation in these cases and that the staff involved fell outside the equal pay settlement as the Department for Finance and Personnel was not responsible for their pay. That is the legal position, but there remains the issue of fairness and, I believe, the moral position. These people are entitled to the extra pay that their colleagues enjoy. We know that some £26 million had been ring-fenced for that purpose within the PSNI alone. Some will say that the money had been reserved just in case the judgment had gone the other way. But clearly, a case had been made on the quantum. I do not wish to apportion blame on anyone, but the fact remains that there are concerns about why business cases were not provided which were adequate, and that the unions did not press the respective employers to ensure that all their members received equal pay for equal work. There was some assurance from the then head of the civil service to the members of the staff involved about rights back in 1996, but the court decided that it was not contractually binding. However, whilst the judge found that there was no legal duty to pay, he had some sympathy with the moral issue, which was for others to decide. The then Finance Minister, Mr. Simon Hamilton, appeared to share that view and estimated that a figure between £32.5 million and £50 million would need to be set aside. He stated that he would put a recommendation to the executive ministers on this basis in early last year. And I quote, Mr. Deputy Speaker, "There is a need to recognise the very strong moral argument that has been put forward." End of quote. I believe that this issue still remains in the executive with no decision made. Mr. Deputy Speaker, there is a high moral argument to resolve the outstanding matter without further delay. I trust that the House will support the motion and that the executive will make a decision without any more delay. The Sinn Féin amendment attempts to lay the blame on the British government. But as the posts were devolved and had pay delegation, I cannot see the logic in their amendment and therefore do not accept it. Thank you, Mr. Deputy Speaker.
I call Mr. Raymond McCartney to move the amendment.
I will be speaking on the amendment, and I think at the outset, let me say that we have no real issues with the main motion. I think if Mr. Cree had have read the amendment, I don't think we're apportioning blame on anyone. What we're saying is that the British government was the employer at the time through the NIO, and that representation should be made to see if they have anything to address in this particular issue. So it's not about apportioning blame. So therefore, I hope maybe in light of that and some of the remarks which we will make, that perhaps dividing the House isn't necessary, because I think that the competent motion would deal with the issue. This is an issue which I know has been dealt with in a number of ways in the last number of years. Indeed, on the 4th of June 2013, there was a debate here in the Assembly, and I stated on behalf of Sinn Féin that for us, and I'm quoting, this is an issue of equality of treatment and fairness, and that remains our position. I said then and that none of us could predict the outcome, but it was an issue that wasn't going to go away until it was addressed, and I think that has come to pass. Indeed, any quick look at the Research and Information Services packet on this showed that it has been raised by all the parties. I think something like 42 different members across the variety of instruments open to us, plenary, DFP committee, the Justice Committee, Assembly questions and oral questions to both ministers, has tabled all the questions and, if you like, ventilated all the issues, but there has been no resolution to this. So therefore, it's an issue that remains unresolved, and at its core is an issue around equality of treatment of people who were civil servants, who are public service workers and who have provided a service. There's no doubt that a big, if you like, sort of rupture in this was the legal case where it was ruled that there was no legal entitlement, and in many ways from that this has been an issue which has proved very difficult to resolve. I would agree with Leslie Cree in his presentation, and indeed in the wording of the motion, because you know sometimes a legal judgment, and it's binding, and nobody's going to doubt it's binding in nature. But it does leave space, and indeed the judge, when he spoke at the judgment, did say around a sense of grievance, a lack of fairness, but the legal entitlement was something which he could only rule on the legal position. And there's no doubt, and this has been brought in front of the Justice Committee, which I sit on, and on a number of occasions the department officials try to explain, if you like, the complexity. These were people who were once in the employment. There was a pay delegation that they were treated separately. They were treated separately when they were employees of the NIO and the old police authority. But that aside, there's absolutely no doubt that when the equal pay settlement was realised and accepted across a number of departments, and indeed across a range of civil servants, there was a group of people who were left outside. And for them, they still carry that sort of sense that it wasn't addressed in a proper way. I don't want to be unkind, but what we have seen, and as I say, there was a debate here on June 2013. Since that, we have seen like a game of ping pong where it's threw back from one department to the other. Both departments, in fairness to them, have said that this is an issue which could be addressed, but there still is no resolution. And that's why we believe in some attempt to try and break the logjam of this, and we don't, and our motion very, very clearly says that. We don't bring it down to two particular departments. We try to say it's an issue for the executive and remains an issue for the executive. I won't take it.
It sounds as if it's no one's fault, but is it not the situation? Certainly in answers that I have suggest it is, that a paper from the finance minister has been waiting in the in-tray of the executive for 18 months. And Sinn Féin have blocked the discussion at the executive on this issue. Is that not the truth of the matter? And is that not why this matter has been truncated and failure to reach a settlement on it?
No, I would disagree. One of the reasons why is because the two departments haven't taken responsibility. Who is wholly responsible? So I think it's wrong to say that, and I think, you know, as Mr. Arthur often does, he looks for the bogeyman, and Sinn Féin's the easy one. Perhaps it's very, very easy to play it out there. This is an issue which is broader than trying to put the blame on one particular party or another. This is an issue which needs resolved in the interest of the people who lost out on an equal pay claim.
But there are issues for the executive, which the executive need to address. But as I say, this goes back to 1996 when the NIO took a decision that these civil servants would be in their remit under their terms and conditions, and that they walked away from it. So therefore, what we're doing in relation to this particular motion and this amendment is saying that the executive should open up discussions with the British government to see what their responsibilities are, and if they have responsibilities, in our opinion they do, then it's up to them to address it, because in times past, in our situations, in very generous settlements for other state agencies, they weren't found wanting in sums with a quantum far, far higher than what these civil servants are doing. So in my opinion, I will state very, very clearly, I and Sinn Féin personally believe that the British government have a responsibility in this, and up to now they have abdicated it. That's why we have tabled the amendment. We realise that the executive has a role to play in it, and in our opinion should not be found wanting, but the British government can't walk away from it either.
I'll ask one clear.
I call Dolores Kelly.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, I and other members of my party have spoken about what is a very clear inequality in terms of equal pay claim over the last number of years. And whilst I have a lot of empathy and indeed sympathy that the fault line lies with the failure of the British government to honour not only the commitment to these people but many other commitments, not least to victims here in the North, and indeed those where the legacy cases are still outstanding, where they've been found against it within the EU. However, Mr Deputy Speaker, it's my understanding, and I look forward to hearing what the Minister has to say in terms of the proposals that are firmly on the table as opposed to some that might well be in the ether, and having had some discussions with some of the people impacted upon, I think what I understand to be the case is that a bird in the hand is worth something or two in the bush, or something that the more certainty around a proposal that I believe is with the executive and that has been held up for a considerable period of time for whatever reason. And therefore, I see the proposal that's before us from the Ulster Unionist Party as something that, whilst it falls far short of actually reaching the needs and the aspirations of the people who were most impacted by this failure. But again, as others have said, there is no legal obligation on the executive. There is, however, I think all of us are agreed, a moral obligation. But we are living in constrained times, and there is some proposal that will assist the majority of people who have made equal pay claims right away, if the executive agrees the paper from the finance minister. That's my clear understanding. It's something I look forward to. I note the Sinn Féin amendment goes further and talks about staff seconded from arm's length bodies. Now, to the best of my knowledge, that's a new addition. It's something that I wasn't as totally aware of as those civilian staff within the broad justice system. But I do think these people have been making the case for a very long time, and I'm sure many of them would very much prefer to have some certainty around what is on offer, even though it falls short of what their expectations and I think what true justice would agree to give them. But nonetheless, there is an offer on the table, and it's my understanding people are prepared to accept something less than that to which they had aspired. So, Mr Deputy Speaker, I look forward to hearing some clarity as to the position from the Finance Minister. We're hearing two conflicting views in relation to why the hold-up has occurred, and perhaps if the Minister could bring us some certainty around that and give us some information around those staff who have been seconded to arm's-length bodies to see the impact on the numbers and what that budget might be, and whether or not the Executive will consider the needs of those staff in addition to putting on the table to those staff who have an offer potentially within their grasp. Thank you, Deputy Speaker.
I call Stuart Dixon.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. Deputy Speaker, I've been a trade union official most of my working life, and I've represented and also dealt with many similar cases like this. I've also, as a member of this Assembly, received a great number of letters from constituents who have been affected by this matter. But the reality is that when their trade union went to the court, they lost the case. And in those circumstances, it became exceedingly difficult, if not impossible, for departments to make any payments by way of an ex gratia payment with regards to this. It's my understanding that Treasury did set aside a sum of money in the eventuality of a win in the courts, but that money came off the table the moment the case was lost in the courts. We are therefore in a situation where people have a very strong sense of unfairness around the way in which they have been treated, and of that there's absolutely no doubt. But there is no legal standing for unfairness. That leaves us in the situation where effectively we are asking the Minister of Finance to make an ex gratia payment by way of compensation in respect of these matters. Whether that will stand up to public scrutiny remains to be seen. And whether ultimately a finance minister who makes that payment would be criticised by public audit or others in respect of making those payments. I also would like the finance minister to comment on the issue that if she were to make an ex gratia payment by way of compensation for unfairness rather than any court decision, how would she propose to divide money between any claimants? Would it be an equal amount each? Because it's my understanding if she were to do that, then some people would actually be receiving more than perhaps their entitlement would be if the court had found in their favour, and others would be receiving substantially less. The trade union has spent a great deal of time, money and effort fighting this valiantly on behalf of those people who it represents, and that is its job. But I think the time has come for the executive to deal with this matter finally and unequivocally. If the minister can find and justify the resources, well and good. If she can't, then it's her duty to be honest and open with those people who may have a residual expectation of some form of payment. Thank you.
I call Bronwyn McGahan.
Gurmi Ogat and I rise to support the amended motion. Ken Corlier, thank you for being given an opportunity to address the House on the issue of inequality of treatment which has arisen for staff in the PSNI, the Department of Justice and the NAO in terms of the equal pay settlement, recognising, in the words of the motion before us, the genuine hurt and hardship which have been caused as a result. I wish to acknowledge those very strong feelings among staff who have been affected disproportionately by current equal pay settlement. My party colleague, Raymond McCartney, has given a very comprehensive outline as to our rationale for the amendment. As we have stated, this is a responsibility for the British Government. They do need to step up to the plate as the employers for many of those affected and to ensure that staff are not disproportionately affected. To conclude, approval must be given for a payment which would not be derogatory. Gurmi Ogat.
I call Mike Nesbitt.
Deputy Speaker, thank you very much. This is a debate, of course, on the motion, but I think it's a bit more than that. It's also a debate about what we think characterises good government. Do we include values like fairness, openness, transparency? Do we value the ability to make decisions, tough decisions, the ability to stand over and justify the decisions we make? The history of this campaign by a section of our citizens for fair treatment, I think, is highly illustrative of the dysfunction of this round of devolution. Because this is about how we, as an assembly and as an executive committee of that assembly, do business on behalf of our people. I just don't think it's possible to sit with some of those affected by this issue and not leave the room determined to right a wrong. I was hearing earlier today of a woman with 40 years' service, public service, who wanted to retire, whose health dictated that she should retire, but she couldn't bring herself to retire because she was afraid if she did, she would lose out if a resolution came to this dispute. It may not be judged as a wrong in strict legal terms, but it is a wrong. How can you look people in the eye who during the Troubles ran the same risks as members of the security forces? people working in police stations, people working in courthouses, people who had to check under their cars for fear of terrorist attack, people who had to consider themselves and their families at constant risk, and then deny them the same rights as former colleagues. How well have we done, Deputy Speaker? There is a hefty volume, as has been pointed out by the member for Foyle, a volume of record of debate, of committee hearings, assembly questions, oral and written. Here's just a flavour of that debate over the last number of years. 2.5 years ago, then Finance Minister Sammy Wilson, he said, the issue of the payment to those who work as administrative assistants in the PSNI has been one I've received a lot of correspondence on. I have some sympathy with the arguments that people have put forward. Tea and sympathy, but without the tea. Skip forward a year, and his successor, Simon Hamilton, says the issue should be resolved as a matter of urgency. That was June of last year, a matter of urgency. He again acknowledges widespread support that there supposedly has been for a resolution. Supposedly. Well, is he pointing a finger at Sinn Féin? I doubt it. Mr. Flanagan of Sinn Féin acknowledged that there is a large number of retired civil servants disgruntled that the settlement is a belated response for people who were discriminated against throughout their careers and are still waiting justice. So from Sinn Féin's point of view, it's clearly core business. And as recently as April of this year, in a written question to FM and DFM, asking about this plan submitted by the Minister of Finance and Personnel to the Executive, what was the status of it? The response from the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, quote, executive business and all aspects of the executive decision-making process are confidential. So tea and sympathy without the tea or the sympathy. Is that a flavour of an open, transparent government? Does that give you a taste of a government that actually cares? I'm well aware of the legal case and the judgment of His Honour Judge Babington in March of 2013. And we can debate that ruling all day. Was the case well made? Was the ruling solid? But whatever the legal niceties, there's no question that there is a moral obligation to step in here. I've heard it said by some former executive ministers that they accept the moral obligation, irrespective of what the courts have had to say. And I agree, there is a moral obligation. It's not my idea of government to wash our hands when things go wrong. As I see it, Deputy Speaker, the facts are pretty simple. People made a decision about their future employment without the full knowledge of the implications of that decision, and they should have been given the full knowledge of the implications. They should have had that information, and the lack of it gives rise to a moral obligation, an obligation on us to do the right thing. I say you cannot listen to those who spent a lifetime in public service only to feel betrayed by what has happened.
Would the member draw his remarks to the close?
Mr. Hamilton talks of a moral obligation. To me, a moral obligation is something that you talk about in terms of a full and final settlement, not a gesture. It is time for a full and final settlement for these.
The member's time is up. I call Jim Allister.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. The unedifying failure to resolve this long-standing grievance does not speak well of government. These were public servants who thought they were doing the right thing, were assured they were doing the right thing, were assured that they would be recompensed, who took upon themselves the dangers very often that came with working in police stations, and now find themselves disadvantaged. That is a wrong that needs to be righted. And it should have been righted long since. And the delay in this is quite unforgivable in many ways. Now, I would like the Minister to clarify a number of things for us. Because we've listened to Sinn Féin in this debate suggesting that really it's no one's real fault what's happened here. But if I followed this saga correctly, and from the questions I've asked the Finance Minister from time to time, I believe I have, but I stand to be corrected, my understanding is that this Minister's predecessor, Mr. Hamilton, drafted a paper of proposal to resolve this matter for discussion by the executive 18 months ago, and that to this very day, that paper has never got before the executive, because any paper to get to the executive needs the imprimatur of both the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister, and the Deputy First Minister has refused to allow it onto the agenda. Now, can the Minister be emphatically clear, is that correct? Because if that is correct, then the finger is pointing back at Sinn Féin on this issue. And is there a real problem that many of these people dared to work in police stations? Is that their real difficulty in regard to this? So let's have some clarity in that issue, and I look forward to the Minister making the situation very, very clear. Could I also ask the Minister, can she clarify for those long-waiting civil servants who have wanted to retire but have been fearful of retiring lest they lose out, can she give a guarantee that they will not lose out, that that which has been accorded to them will continue, and that they will be assured of payment? Yes, I'll give away.
I listen with interest to the members' theories about the intervention of Sinn Féin, but the Department of Justice wrote to the Justice Committee, and in correspondence they said, in responding on the 8th of August to Simon Hamilton, the newly appointed finance minister, etc., etc., the minister has also noted the reference to ministerial direction, which, although technically possible to be used, he would not be planning to do so in this case, and DFP had no such plans. That was in the event of the fact that he had no other legal route to make the payment. So it may be blocked somewhere else, but the reality is that the finance minister himself at the time was simply not prepared to make a decision, a ministerial direction decision, in respect of this matter.
The member's an extra minute.
One's not talking about a ministerial direction decision. One's talking about an executive decision. Whatever's in the minister's paper, it obviously requires executive approval. And it's frozen until it gets before the executive and gets approval. So I'm clarifying with the minister, is the reason why it hasn't got to the executive because of Sinn Féin's obstruction of it? I think we need to hear that. Then we hear from Sinn Féin all this talk about really the British government should meet their responsibilities. Well, again, I'm sure the minister can correct me, but surely the obligation, moral or legal or quasi both, which falls on the fact that these were civil servants seconded from within devolved institutions to PSNI, etc. And therefore the obligation does not lie on the British government. The obligation surely lies with those from whom they were seconded with the assurance that they would not be prejudiced in making the move. So if these were civil servants who came from Northern Ireland departments to go and work in NIO departments, then the body that was underwriting the assurance that they wouldn't be prejudiced was surely the devolved departments. And therefore, is this not a case that the primary obligation rests not on this occasion with the British government, but with the devolved departments, and that's who should be finding the money for this? And lastly, I think it would be shameful if these deserving people were to become some sort of pawn in a tug of war with the British government in any negotiations about money. There's a wrong to be righted. Let it be righted forthwith.
I now call on the Minister of Finance and Personnel, Mrs. Arlene Foster, to respond to the debate.
Thank you very much, Mr. Deputy Speaker, and I very much welcome the opportunity to participate in today's debate on the moral argument for payments to be made to those civilian staff who have worked for the Police Service of Northern Ireland, or as it used to be, the Police Authority, or who have worked in the Northern Ireland office in those sections that are now in the Department of Justice. It might be helpful, and I know colleagues have talked about the background of this case, but just for the record, I think it would be helpful if I briefly explained why the Northern Ireland Civil Service equal pay settlement did not apply to these staff. NIPSA brought an equal pay claim against NICS on the basis that the predominantly male technical grade staff enjoyed a pay lead over the corresponding predominantly female administrative grade staff, and a settlement was negotiated for eligible staff in the affected grades, which included an increase in pay and a compensatory lump sum. And during the period covered by that settlement, there were pay delegations in place for both the Police Authority and the Northern Ireland Office. And the pay delegation means that those bodies could settle their own pay arrangements. And because of the pay delegation, staff in both organisations were unable to use the NICS staff as comparators. No internal equal pay liabilities for either the police service or the NIO, similar to those upon which the Northern Ireland Civil Service settlement was based, were identified, and therefore staff were unable to bring equal pay claims. However, as a result of the equal pay settlement, these groups did implement any corresponding increases in pay where they followed NICS pay rates, and indeed, as I understand it, the police service voluntarily followed the NICS pay upgrade, whilst the NIO and the Department of Justice implemented different scales. NIPSA lodged a number of test cases in the county court against the Northern Ireland Civil Service departments, alleging a breach of contract caused by management not applying the complete terms of the settlement to these staff, and as has been mentioned, those cases were dismissed by Judge Babington in March of 2013. He found that the pay delegations were lawfully exercised and that therefore there was no legal entitlement for these staff to have access to the equal pay settlement except where they had service in the NICS. So the legal position is clear. I think that's accepted right across the House. Mention was made by Mr Cree about the £26 million being ring-fenced in the PSNI budget, but that money, of course, once the legal case was lost, that money was no longer ring-fenced and the legal liability was no longer there, so that money is not there anymore, just to be clear. And the legal position is important because the Northern Ireland Civil Service cannot pay out money to staff without a legal basis to do so. NIPSA, the union, despite having lost the legal argument, has continued to encourage staff to lobby MLAs for a payment on the basis of a moral argument. And the moral argument put forward is that if those organisations had not been given separate delegation powers and had fallen within DFP pay determination powers, the staff would have been included in the equal pay settlement. And I've listened to staff, met many of them, they've written to me, they've spoken to me, they've sometimes got to me by some unorthodox methods, which I'll not go into today, and I've heard what they've had to say. Their representatives have written to me from right across the chamber as well, and indeed my predecessors, so I do understand very well the arguments that are being made and the strength of feeling behind this. Staff believe that they should not be subject to differences in financial outcome for having served in what have been very difficult areas of time right throughout the Troubles, and I would like to place on record my thanks to all staff who worked in those areas, Mr Deputy Speaker, during very, very difficult times for this country. The difficulty in finding a resolution to this issue is no reflection of the esteem in which these staff are held. And if this issue is to be dealt with in the way suggested by staff and their representatives, it is absolutely essential that the matter is considered by the Northern Ireland Executive. I hear what Mr Dixon said about an ex gratia payment based on a direction from the Minister of Finance and Personnel, but it is clear to me that this is a novel, contentious and cross-cutting issue, and therefore it should come to the Executive. And that is what we propose to do. And this is there would need to be legislation to provide a route for payment, and indeed his colleague, the Minister for Justice, in response to the paper that has been submitted to the Executive, made that very point. How would the payment be made? Would it be made through the Financial Assistance Act, or would we need other legislation to bring it forward? So that point is made. We do need legislation if we are to go down that route, because departments cannot pay out money without the legal cover to do so. So there would need to be legislation. Yes, we'll give way. Yeah.
Why can't it not be paid through the Financial Assistance Act?
Well, as I understand it,
understand that they have looked at the Financial Assistance Act and don't believe that they have the legal vires to pay it through that particular act, and we would need other legislation. I'm not saying that that's a problem. I'm just saying that we would need to probably put in place other legislation to make the payments out. But most fundamentally, yes, I will.
Thank you very much, Minister. Just, I don't know whether you're aware or not, but the Social Security Agency had pay delegation as well, but they got the full terms of the settlement.
What I say to you, Mr. Cray, is that they must have followed the NICS through their pay delegation. Their pay delegation, they must have decided to follow the NICS route. And the police authority did not decide to go down that route, and neither did the NIO or the DOJ later on. Yes, Mr. Cussie.
Sorry, Minister, I'm confused, but as you know, that happens quite a lot. The delegation that was with the policing board was that they could have made a decision, because the wording of a advice received from the DFP on the 22nd of February 2011 clearly affirmed the DOJ's understanding pay and grading delegation that had been granted to the NIO in 1996 was to include the Northern Ireland Policing Board, formerly PSNI, and this pay delegation had not been rescinded. Was the pay delegation then still in the realm of the policing board?
The pay delegation remains with the PSNI, and that's where I think some members made discussion about the issue of a business case coming up to DFP through the Department of Justice. So the pay delegation still remains with the PSNI, so it would be the policing board in actual fact now. In terms of an agreement from the executive around the basis for calculation of payments, setting out precisely who would be entitled to such a payment and where the money to make such a payment would come from, clearly that has to be by agreement at the executive table. And you'll all be very much aware in this House of the very difficult budgetary situation facing Northern Ireland and facing the executive, and therefore we would need to agree together where the money for this expenditure would come from in order to deal with the issues. And it's no small issue. Financially speaking, the full cost paying staff amounts equivalent to the equal pay settlement would be over £30 million. The further cost of including arm's length bodies, which of course has been an amendment here today, could mean a further £10 million. And those are not insubstantial sums, particularly when we have the current very difficult financial climate we are experiencing at present. But Mr. Alistair asked me the question about the executive paper, and I think, of course, he does deserve an answer. It is my understanding that Sinn Féin has prevented the matter getting on to the executive agenda, and that we have not been able to have that discussion around the table, because obviously, from a First Minister's point of view, it's a paper that comes from a DUP ministry. Therefore, we do want to have the matter dealt with, and we haven't been able to have that discussion around the table. Turning to the amendment from Sinn Féin members, I don't think the amendment adds anything to the original motion. In fact, it actually underlines some of the difficulties I have mentioned in making a payment to PSNI and NIO staff. By including other arm's length bodies in the amendment, it actually widens the potential groups for consideration for a payment, and that, frankly, is not helpful to those people who have been looking for this payment for quite a considerable length of time. I could, of course, consider referring the matter to the Westminster Government as suggested, but Westminster made money available for the original NICS equal pay settlement on the basis of clear legal advice on liability, not because they were responsible for what had happened, but because the sum of money at the time, £130 million, was so huge that we needed to access money from Her Majesty's Treasury to meet the liability. It's not, unfortunately, the same for the staff in question today. We've heard that there is no legal liability in relation to the matter. So the executive needs to move on this issue. You'll all be aware that my predecessor, Simon Hamilton, wanted to find a way in which we could recognise the moral argument. He took the first step in getting the issue considered by circulating that paper, outlining a recommendation that could have agreed achieve a resolution for the staff. The paper has been circulated. It hasn't been tabled for formal consideration, although a number of executive colleagues have given their views on the paper. I made reference to the Justice Minister's views on the paper, the Ulster Unionist Minister at the time, also the DRD Minister clearly said that he wanted very clear eligibility criteria set in relation to budgetary matters. So there have been certain comments made in relation to the paper, but it's a very complex issue. There are a number of risks that would need to be considered. The risk that a payment to this group of staff could undermine the original equal pay settlement if there was a differential in the amounts paid, that's Mr Dixon's point. The potential repercussions to other groups such as the arm's length bodies. How would differences in pay rates between the NIO and the NICS be taken into account in any payment? So we have to consider all of those issues in the round, or we'll end up in court, frankly, being challenged by another group or whatever in relation to this issue. So the executive will need to be very clear about any eligibility for recognition of a moral argument, and they would need to consider any payment from this group of staff in relation to a range of issues, including budget, grades, time period affected to avoid an extension of the moral argument and associated costs to other groups of staff. I wish I could come to this debate, Mr Deputy Speaker, with a firm, positive answer to these staff, but in the current political and financial climate, I'm concerned that there's no immediate or indeed clear route to the outcome at present. To Mr Alistair's point that there are people fearful to retire in case they are not able to take up an offer if it were to come through, I can only say to you what I believe in respect of that, because ultimately it will be for the executive to decide on eligibility. But from my point of view, I would certainly be very sympathetic to looking at this issue for those people who retire now and who miss out if there were to be a payment later on. But as I say, it is a matter for the entire executive. And I do hope that the paper which Minister Hamilton circulated can reach the agenda of the executive soon, and that a resolution is found through cooperation and agreement. But I'm not going to mislead people. This will not be an easy issue, Mr Deputy Speaker, but they can be assured that they have my sympathy and indeed understanding as to why they should be considered for a payment.
I call Sean Lynch to wind on the amendment.
I think one thing this debate did throw up was that there was a lot of people agreed on many things. I think one of the first things people said, it needed to be resolved. It was an issue of equality and fairness. Everybody said there was no legal route. The judge had made its, their decision. There was a moral argument around this issue. And everybody was sympathetic. And like what the Minister said, we've all got letters over a period of years on this particular issue. And I would take issue with Mr. Jim Alistair by saying that we had difficulties. We have absolutely no difficulties on this issue. It's essentially an issue of equality. And I think much... No, I'm not. I have only 5 minutes. No. I just want to cover a number of issues outlined by people, and Mr McCree, who moved the motion, talked about equality and fairness. There have been many questions asked over the years, written questions, debates, representation made to the bodies, and that the people were entitled to their payments, and that the judge had ruled, and he more or less had left it open that it was a moral issue for others to decide. I would disagree with him that about our amendment. Our amendment is clearly that it's a responsibility of the British government, NAO. These people were originally employed by them, and therefore they should pay. Rim McCartney, my colleague, as the point I had made, the British were the employee had employed these people. Therefore, they were responsible. Equality of treatment and fairness, and I think this has been on the record that Sinn Féin has done in the past. The issue isn't going away, and it has been about for a long time. And it has been raised by all parties, and again, it was brought, I'm on the Justice Committee, and the officials came after, I think it was about a month after the judgment, outlining the restraints they had come to their table, and they couldn't resolve it. And I do agree with the Minister. It is not easy. It is a complex issue. Nobody's saying any different. Rim McCarty continued. The debate was in 2013. It went to the department. There was a logjam. This is for an issue as outlined in our amendment for the executive to go out to and lobby the British government. And I think the minister said a figure of 30 million. It's a fair amount of money wherever we get it from. Dolores Kelly, again, fairness and equality coming through. She was interested in what the minister was going to say to get some clarity. I don't know whether the member got clarity or not. Again, a moral obligation. Stuart Dixon dealt with similar issues, probably in a different role, or I don't know whether it was within this assembly or not. Remember, the reality was the case was lost in the courts. Finance Minister making a payment, how would this work? I think that the Minister herself has outlined that. Brum and McGahan, again, the hurt on those who were affected. Mike Nesbitt, how do we do business on behalf of the people we represent? And Jim Allister, delay is quite unforgivable. And we would agree in that sense for those who are affected. Just to conclude, Cian Coghlia, I would ask people to support our amendment.
I now call Ross Hussey to conclude and wind up the debate on the motion.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And my thoughts have been quite hazy this afternoon, listening to some of the comments made here. I want to begin by welcoming the members of the civil service who are here today to watch this debate and hear what's actually going on in this chamber in support of them. I thank the Minister for coming here to give us some answers, but I am disappointed that some of her party colleagues didn't come along to show support to the Northern Ireland civil servants who are affected by this. We have had a debate where everybody has agreed there is a moral argument. Moral arguments will not put money into the pocket of the civil servants concerned. And in 2011, when I stood for election to this House, I met many people throughout the constituency who were concerned about this particular issue. And it's sad to reflect so many years later, we still haven't resolved it. When is a civil servant not a civil servant? Is the sort of question we should be asking here today. Because who employed you in the first place? And the point was made by several, including Mr. Allister, that you were employed by the Department of Finance and Personnel and then allocated to a department. I know that the Police Service of Northern Ireland put forward a business case in October 2010 for discussion. And this is where I get confused, because the Police Service of Northern Ireland put forward a business case to the Department of Justice, which was turned down by the DFP, because it goes back then to the delegation. And who had the delegated authority? Was it the police authority, the policing board, or was it the Department of Finance and Personnel? And that's an issue that will have to continue to be discussed. Everybody agrees this payment should be made in some way or another, but who should pay it? And I'm sure the civil servants concerned don't care where the money comes from. They want what everybody agrees is morally theirs. But the sad reality is we are playing ping pong. The sad reality is somebody is blocking this from getting onto the executive table. The Minister has made it very clear that proposals were put forward by Simon Hamilton. Those proposals have not yet got to the executive table and they're being blocked. And if they are being blocked by Sinn Féin, shame on Sinn Féin. And if they are being blocked by Sinn Féin, I suggest that you stop it. Because you cannot sit in a corner and say that you support equal rights, that you support the payment, that you think you have a moral argument, and then say, but it's the Brits have to pay it. A moral argument is a moral argument regardless of who has to pay it. No, I won't give way. If there is a moral argument that we all agree on, why for once can we not just say, okay, everybody agrees this payment should be made. It is wrong to block it for any reason. Let the paper go to the executive and discuss it at least. Because if it is being blocked, and I say if it is being blocked by Sinn Féin, remove that blockage and let it be discussed in the executive. I will go no further than that, because I do not know what happens in the executive. I doubt very much whether Mike Nesbitt will ever appoint me to be a minister to find out. But if you are sitting there, I suggest that you stop the blockage. There is a moral argument for this payment to be made. Everybody has agreed with it. There are no difficulties, it's an equality, it's everybody's fault but ours. If it's being blocked, remove the blockage and pay it. Civil servants sitting up there that have served this country loyally for 40 years and more, civil servants who worked in police stations when the terror threat against them was as high as it was against any police officer, civil servants who were locked into police stations because that station was under attack, civil servants who were attacked because they opened a courthouse. I could go on, because I have met these people. They have made representations to myself, to my party members, and indeed to Sinn Féin members. So for once, let us get the nonsense out of the way. There is a moral argument here, and the moral simply is we pay up. And that is what I want to see happen. So I call on Sinn Féin this evening to remove any block that you have on this going to the executive table. I support the motion.
Members, the question is that the amendment standing on the marshal's list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Aye. I think the noes have it. I think the no. The question will be put again in 3 minutes. Could I ask members to resume their seats? Order, members. Would members resume their seat?
Members, the question is that the amendment standing on the marshalled list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? The following tellers have been appointed. Tellers for the ayes, Sean Lynch and Bronwyn McGahan. Tellers for the noes, Danny Kennedy and Ross Hussey. Clear the lobbies. The House, the Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
Order, members. Would members resume their seat? Clerk, read the result.
64 members voted, 28 members voted aye, 36 members voted no. The amendment therefore falls.
The amendment falls. The amendment falls. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that this Assembly do now adjourn. The Assembly is adjourned.